perfect blossom is a rare thing.
You could spend your life looking for one, and it would not be a wasted life.
Anthropology is the study of human culture. I'm often asked why I chose anthropology to be my major. Well, I always say that it helps me have an open mind. It helps me accept everyone for who they are and know that everyone comes from a different background. I'm happy that I have that understanding. I would like everyone to meet Mr. Howarder. I find Mr. Howarder to be a very powerful person. I mean, to be wise and knowledgeable, and to be able to survive with a family without using a system that is failing us by the second, our own government. And I find that amazing. And that's why I really felt like I had to document this. It had to be seen by someone. I would like everyone to meet my teacher, Dr. Casagrande. He's a really cool guy. I learned a lot from him. Religion or spirituality?
I said it's the crutch. Religion is the crutch that man uses because he can't walk with the creator of his own 2 feet. Religion is the crutch that man uses because he can't walk with the creator of his own 2 feet. Spiritual, yes. I think spiritual is the goal. Religion can be a means to that end, but it can also lead you to a dead end and you just end up in this ritual that means nothing for your duration here.
So how are you? We're wrestling with what is spiritual.
I don't trust my own 2 hands exclusively. I believe we have been given an earth, a raw material by a creator. Here it is. Dress it and keep it. Tend to it. Improve upon it. Maintain it. Draw from it. Experiment with it. See what can be done. I don't just take things as they're given, you know, I don't just follow the status quo. I'm seeking that ability to take a plant and know what it's good for. I'm seeking the ability to hear a rabbit scream in the woods, be able to follow the trail. Okay, what just killed it? Where did it come from? What else is this telling me about my surroundings? You know, this is ethereal stuff, but it's all part of what it used to be to live on this earth without big corporate systems, paying attention to every detail of nature. That's, to me, that's spiritual.
Don't sign your life away.
All we've been taught to do is sign our name repeatedly. Sign away your life repeatedly. Learn how to sign away your oaths, no problem. Don't sign anything to start until you research it to the very end. There's a maximum of law that says the origin of a thing ought to be looked
at.
What am I signing here? But to get back to a specific question, a republic comes from the res publica, free from things public. The public, there's public law in the United States, there's private law. Public law deals with the public, the consenting, the voters, the U.S. citizens, those who have chosen to become part of the corporate democracy, rather than the republic. In the republic, you're free. You're also responsible for your own. In the democracy, you can lean on Cain and Nimrod's system to support you if need be. I choose to be in the republic. I don't know that I have purified that walk, but I'm walking toward that. They don't want you to know the republic is there anymore. Oh yeah, we're a republic. They tell you, but they don't tell you the nature of it. The U.S. corporate democracy is just like Walmart. It's corporate on American soil. It just offered benefits.
What is compost?
Compost, I think, is the best tool we've been given as far as maintaining the earth and healing the wounds that have been inflicted on the soils. Compost is kind of the what I started with when I realized, okay, it's going to be all for me now. I was raised gardening and making compost piles, but when it really hit me, okay, Tim, you're completely in charge of your food supply. I started hauling compost from area municipalities, grass clippings, wood chips, leaves, what have you, and built small piles. I had an old pickup truck at the time and a pitchfork. I also had my heavy equipment, but I really wasn't thinking. You know, I started small with it, and then opportunities kept coming. People would call and say, hey, will you come get this pile of manure? And so on and so forth. The sawmill up the road here has sawdust and was given it to me by the semi-load. Sawdust is almost pure carbon. And of course, your manure piles are your nitrogen sources. Green grass clippings are nitrogen sources. Pile it all together, and if you get the right CN ratio, which is roughly 25 or 30 to 1, that's complex. Just think half and half, sawdust, manure. Sawdust, grass clippings. It's going to heat anaerobic, or not anaerobic, aerobic thermophilic bacteria are going to wake up to their preferred situation, which is a hot compost pile. They both create and thrive on the heat. And the heat kills weed seeds, it kills pathogens, and I don't know what else it might do for breaking down and properly combining the nutrients in a pile to take all that raw material that's too rich, too basic for the soil to use, but after it's compost, it's already black dirt, and you can spread that and improve on anything. I've got thousands of semi-loads. I've put my life now into building compost piles. That's what I do. I go to the sale barns, I go to the Canton yard waste dumps, I bring in all the material I can. There's a small pile, we pass a small pile. I've got three piles against my house in a concrete bay. I build those in October, they heat until April, and they make about a 10 degree difference in comfort level in the house, and we burn about half the firewood just from that radiant heat on the east side and blocking off the freezing temperature on the east side. It's also handy to girls like it. They can throw their kitchen scraps out that far window right under the pile. As you can see, my son is taking advantage of a couple of mature piles and planted a bunch of onions.
Tim, is that an animal you're composting in the center bin, or
yes,
is that just something?
As a matter of fact, we were in the thick of it with lots and lots of material, and I was doing some reading. Rodale's Complete Book of Compost, an old 1960s vintage book about that thick. And I was just thoroughly fascinated when my father gave me his copy, because I was composting, and then I read that book, and it opened up everything all brand new. Animals are a very good source of nitrogen and trace minerals, and there was a locker plant in Cuba at the time that had been doing whatever they could to under the table dispose of deer carcasses in the fall. And he approached me and said, Tim, can we dump those out there? And I said, sure, we'll mix them with some sawdust and just compost them. Well, he brought me 600. Oh. And that was no problem. We had 10 semi-loads of compost out there in that area where we, not far from where we just were, composting at the time. I just buried it in the pile of tobacco. And sure enough, 6 months later, you got a bunch of clean bones and a bunch of really rich, black, odorless dirt. Since then, farmers have been bringing us dead animals, cattle, horses, hogs, goats, sheep, everything. And they're very happy to get rid of those things for free because it would cost them otherwise, or be a liability issue. Compost. If you bury that sawdust is going to lock in the odors and the pathogens, and it's a done deal. We've got barrels now full of bones the kids pick up. After the ground mellows, we spread everything out, and we've got a harrow, and it just kind of brings all the trash to the surface, and the kids pick up rocks and sticks and bones. We've got just an old feed mill grinder that we grind the bones in, and it makes just the most beautiful bone meal. Rebroadcast that on the soil.
Yeah, okay.
And the chickens do, you know, they'll eat some as a supplement because of the calcium and the phosphorus and the nitrogen in the bone meal. Everything benefits.
Soil.
Potato bugs won't touch the potatoes that are being grown in the best soil. And the soil off to the sides has still got a little bit of clay base and not as much nutrient. The potato bugs are eating the potatoes. But in the middle, where the plants are healthy, there's no bug problems. And that's true for everything. You know, the beans, the corn, whatever. Healthy plants are their own best protection against insects. What was Eden's soil like? You know, these are the questions that go through my mind while I'm working. Where's the end of this? How far can a guy go and finally say, okay, I guess I can stop here now. I've got it where this is as good as it gets. I haven't found as good as it gets. I have become rather impassioned about compost and soil going now. He could spend his life looking for a perfect blossom, and it wouldn't be a waste of life. I get it.
This is my thinking stance.
Oh, I thought you said you were something.
Oh, yeah. I've given him a few.
Does
that make anyone want to go in the bathroom?
What's in the water?
To do was test the water to see if there were any contaminants in the water. And Tim wanted to have his water tested to see if there was any contaminants in the water. So they came out, and the idea was they stopped at they started at the very top and sampled the water all the way down to the Spoon River. Did they go all the way to the Spoon River?
We went to where this creek's down here to take all my runoff, goes into the,
And so the idea is with all this compost and all this kind of stuff, is nitrogen seeping out into the water? And if that's the case, then you would expect the water to be clean at the top, and you would start to find nitrogen and other kinds of things, and bacteria or anything like that, in the water at the lower elevation, because it's like a little watershed. And what did they find, Tim?
Down there, very little bacteria. He said that water would be considered potable water by the state.
Which is the only reason I'm trying
to. At the end of our tour of his establishment, I just wanted to take a few shots of the animals that lived on the farm. And to sum it all up, it's just simply beautiful. I mean, it's life. It really is beautiful. And I really like this pig a lot. I mean, he was just so fat. Well, I'm gonna end on this note. Anthropology helps us ask the right questions. And sometimes we like the answers and sometimes we don't. But the true beauty lies in asking the question. In some way, we are all seekers, seeking just what we were put on earth for. And I really believe that if you try hard enough, you can find out what you were put on this earth for. Because I know I have. Thank you for watching my first ever visual anthropology documentary. And I also want to thank Mr. Howard for letting me capture this amazing moment in time. And I also want to thank my teacher, Dr. Casagrande. And I also want to state that I am a proud graduate of Western Illinois University. Thank you.